greetings class, what I'm going to do is to give you an introduction to key parts of the labor law chapter. I'm going to start with the history and some of the sources of laws and what they mean, and then I will have other sections that cover different aspects of the chapter. I do like to use pictures when I can, and I'm using pictures in some ways to set the mood. So this first picture, which I obtained through Creative Commons, just kind of illustrates the workers trying to organize to perhaps get more and better working conditions. There are a variety of sources of labor laws. We've looked at some already, but you can see we have a map of the United States in the background of this slide, and that map is there because the labor laws come from state and federal sources. So one of the sources of labor laws are the common law. The common law is only state law, it is not federal law. And we've already looked at some of these laws. We've looked at agency law in chapters 5 and 10, and then we've looked at tort law in chapter 5. If you remember, the common law does not involve a legislature acting, but rather common law is based on judicial decisions that have been made over time. A second source of labor law is contract law. We looked at agency law both in the context of kind of at-will employment, but also there can be contracts that are created that would then define the relationship between an employer and the employee. Some of those contracts are implied. The typical implied contract would be the terms that are included in the handbook that the employee is given, that be an example of an implied contract. Express ones, of course, the employer and the employee spell out the terms that comprise the conditions for the employer to pay and for the employee to work. What we'll be focusing on most, though, in this chapter are enacted laws that apply to the employment relationship. And you can see this chart, and it does look kind of complicated. Okay, so what we have for the enacted laws, we have state and we have federal laws. In terms of the federal laws, the federal labor laws, we have the National Labor Relations Act and all those laws that are related to that. Although I've listed here only the NLRA, realize that includes all of the labor laws that I'm going to talk about in a moment that relate to federal law. We have OSHA, which you maybe can't see as well. We took a look at OSHA already, although we know that in our case, although that's listed as federal law, we also have state laws. And our Cal OSHA is much more stringent and stronger than the state law, than the federal OSHA. If you note, in the line between federal and state, we have a combination of laws. Those are anti-discrimination laws. Those we looked at in chapters 6 and 7. And then I listed them having arrows from both state and federal is because we both have the federal law, Federal Civil Rights Act, but then we also have, in California, for example, we have the state laws that you found in the Department of Fair Housing and Employment. In addition, there are other state laws, and those are both regulations and also laws that have been enacted by the legislature. And so that's what this last box is in the diagram. So those are the sources of the labor laws that we have in the United States. You can see that they're very complicated. What we're focusing on for this chapter, though, are enacted federal laws. So before we continue, though, I want to talk a little bit about the history of collective bargaining. And specifically, I'm focusing on the legal history of collective bargaining, although the legal history and the social history are obviously related. You note in the picture, I tried to find something that looked pretty old. And if you look on the picture, you'll see that I have women who are picketing, and they're picketing as part of the Corset Workers Union Local 318. Now, corset workers, I know that's an old union. You may not even know what a corset is. A corset was a garment that women had to wear to give them a more defined hourglass shape. Some of the corsets were so tight they were tied on, and they'd have someone would actually wrap them in the garment and then use ties like shoelaces. If you remember what shoelaces are, they would use ties like shoelaces to tighten women into the corsets. So this is a representation, though, of unions, a union that is on strike as part of the Corset Workers Union. So, what did we have to begin with? Now, I know that the current sentiment is that unions are unnecessary and interfere with businesses' right to conduct business. And certainly unions do interfere with businesses' rights to or ability to conduct business the way it wants. But I wanted to talk about the two cases that are mentioned in the book, Polis and Hunt, both cases that kind of illustrated the issues that workers faced when they first tried to organize in the early 1900s. And part of what the workers did was they would combine to try to get improved working conditions and working hours and wages. Employers responded by filing suit against them, arguing that the employees were engaged in a criminal conspiracy. The reason I have these two cases together, as they are in the book, is because in Polis, the workers tried to require that employers only hire union shoemakers. And those workers were eventually convicted of criminal conspiracy, a kind of closed shop. In Hunt, the employer argued the same thing, that workers were combining in a conspiracy to prevent other workers from being able to freely work. In that case, in the Hunt case, the court said, well, wait a minute, let's back off this a little bit. They are conspiring, but workers do have the right to engage in concerted activities to improve their working conditions. The difference between the two cases, first, that the Hunt court decided that there was no criminal conspiracy, but the difference was that, not just in the ruling, but in the fact that the courts said that as long as the workers aren't specifically excluding people, and as long as the workers were not stopping a business from operating, then workers have the right to petition to an employer and include and use various methods to try to improve working conditions. So that was a victory for the worker. Then employers began to use the Sherman Act to prohibit workers from combining to create better working conditions and better wages. I forgot to note that the previous slide, the picture was, that was a picture of some criminals. And the reason I had that on there, as you could probably guess, is that it was an argument is that the workers who were combining to try to get better wages and working conditions were criminals. In this case, the Sherman Act said that people or businesses couldn't combine to restrain trade. And what employers argued was that these employees were combining to restrain trade. And the picture that I have here is not a very good representation of that, but it was the idea that these different workers were together, and here in the picture they're together, and they were preventing free trade. and if you believe in the kind of free market system that the U.S. Offers as what our economic system is, then you can't have workers combining to restrain trade. That argument was successful. So again, on the previous theory, previous slide, I talked about criminal conspiracy, and the courts, you know, eventually said, well, it's not really conspiracy. As long as they don't stop you from doing business, they have the right to engage in concerted activity to improve working conditions. But then the courts said, okay, well, under the Sherman Act, though, the workers' actions are actually restricting the freedom of employment and restricting the employer's freedom to choose who the employer wants to work for the employer. So that's a violation of the Sherman Antitrust Act, that the Sherman Antitrust Act applies to workers combining as well as to businesses combining. So what happened is then courts were granting injunctions against workers who were organizing. So then along came the Clayton Act, was adopted by Congress, and what the courts did was to conclude that labor was not commerce. So what I have in the picture is kind of people walking around, buying things, working. You also see on the tables the things they're actually making. And what I wanted to illustrate with this picture is that the workers themselves, although they may be engaging in commerce, labor itself was not commerce. So then the judges said, well, then if that's the case, you can't issue injunctions. But Congress, to clarify even more, passed the Norris LaGuardia Act, which said no more injunctions. You can't get an injunction to stop workers from organizing. Again, there's still the restrictions that they can't organize in a way that prohibits the worker from the employer from doing business, but they can organize to try to protest and try to improve the working conditions. So, all of those other things were more laws to stop employers from stopping workers from organizing. In the 40s, late 30s, well, say 30s on, the Congress decided to step in and enacted labor laws to now get, not just say you can't stop them that way, but to move forward in an affirmative way and say we are encouraging workers. And this is the National Labor Relations Act, the NLRA. I have a quote from your book, which says, the purpose of the NLRA was to eliminate or mitigate the causes of certain substantial obstructions to the free flow of commerce by encouraging collective bargaining and by protecting the exercise by workers of full freedom of association, self-organization, and designation of representatives of their own choosing for the purpose of negotiating the terms and conditions of their employment or other mutual aid or protection. So you can see that this is a difference. Before, it was first anti-unions, and that was the criminal conspiracy theories, to, okay, they could be okay, employers can organize, and that was the Clayton Act and then the Norris LaGuardia Act, to, we are going to protect workers who organize, and that's what the NLRA was. So the adoption of the NLRA in 1947, I said the late 30s, but it was 47, reflected a change in the legal environment of labor relations. So bargaining was a favored method of resolving labor disputes, and that's what Congress decided, is that from now on the employer and the employee need to bargain. And you can see in this diagram I have that the law must balance two interests. One interest is a business's need for workers to produce goods and services and to be successful, and the other is the worker's need for wages, benefits, and safe working conditions. And the NLRA was designed to help that balance by encouraging bargaining as the key way to get improvements in the conditions. So now what I have is a history of all the labor laws that the book talks briefly about. First of all, these federal statutes were adopted because of the Commerce Clause. So the Commerce Clause is a clause in the Constitution that says that Congress has the right to make laws regulating interstate commerce. And that was the basis for Congress to adopt the federal statutes. Across the middle, under the box that says History of Federal Statutes, across the middle I've listed the three major collective bargaining laws. I have the Fair Labor Standards Act kind of off to the side. We looked at it earlier. It's not specifically related to collective bargaining, but it is a federal labor law. So we have the NLRA, which is a Wagner Act, which both defined what employers would do that would be considered unfair labor practices. It provided for secret ballot elections so that employees could choose a representative. It also created the National Labor Relations Board, which I'll talk about in a minute, and it has the supervision power over the laws and regulations relating to both unfair labor practices and conducting elections. Well, after the NLRA was passed, there was a concern that the courts were deciding too much in favor of employers. So Congress adopted the Taft-Hartley Act, which then defined union unfair labor practices. So if you look at the Wagner Act, it defined employer unfair labor practices. Taft-Hartley defined union unfair labor practices and thereby restored some power back to employers because, as I said, the feeling was the trend was more in favor of workers and less in favor of employers. And then the last thing, federal statute, which doesn't directly affect employers but nonetheless is there, part of the collective bargaining laws, is Landrum-Griffin. There was a concern that unions internally were not protecting the money of the workers, for example, the money that was in pension funds. And so Landrum-Griffin was adopted to try to regulate those internal affairs. So that's kind of a broad outline of those statutes. I want to talk about each of them a little bit more. The National Labor Relations Act applied to private employers, defined employee rights such as the right to join a union, the right to choose a representative to negotiate, and a right to engage in concerted activity. So it encouraged collective bargaining. That was the idea. Let's allow the employer and the employee to bargain. And it also created the National Labor Relations Board, whose powers were to conduct the secret union elections for certification and decertification, and to prevent and remedy unfair labor practices committed by either the employer or the union. So that's what was the NLRA. The Taft-Hartley Act amended the NLRA to balance that relationship. So the NLRA gives employees the right to join or assist unions. Taft-Hartley adds the right of employees not to join a union, because, as I said, the feeling was that employees were going too far in forcing people to join. The NLRA prohibits management from discriminating against employees on the basis of union membership. Taft-Hartley prohibits the union from discriminating against non-union employees. So again, first you had the NLRA, which was very protective of employees and the right to organize. Then you had Taft-Hartley, which was an effort by Congress to balance the spreadsheet a little more, balance the laws a little more. So the key for the employee is the right to engage in concerted activity. Employees have the right to strike or picket or do work slowdowns for better economic or working conditions under the NLRA. However, the employees cannot interfere with the employer's ability to conduct business. And we'll talk a little more about the strikes and all of that. I'll do that in another set of PowerPoint slides. The Fair Labor Standards Act set the minimum hour wage, overtime wages, and prohibited child labor. You looked at that already. And I've outlined that again, except here I added that executives and workers that are paid on commission, depending on what it is, are exempt from that. So that's it for the first part of this information on collective bargaining.